हेलो नमस्कार आदाब, मैं हूं संजय रॉय न्यू दिल्ली से आपका होस्ट। आप सभी का स्वागत करता हूं हमारा ये कार्यक्रम जिसका शीर्षक है भारतीय ललित कला का इतिहास पाषाण काल से आधुनिक काल तक।
हेलो एवरीवन, माय नेम इज आशना विवेक एब्रॉल एंड आई एम फ्रॉम मुंबई। टुडे आई विल बी योर होस्ट फॉर दिस प्रोग्राम of fine arts from Stone Age to contemporaries today. So without further ado, let's get started.
भारत के आजादी के 75वें वर्षगांठ के उपलक्ष में ये कार्यक्रम आपके सम्मुख लेके आए हैं मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ कल्चर वेस्ट जोन, इसलिए उनका धन्यवाद। यूं तो हमारा देश भारत 1947 में आजाद हुआ था, लेकिन भारत की ललित कला का इतिहास उतनी ही पुरानी है जितनी की हमारी गंगा नदी और सिंधु नदी। ललित कला हम इंसानों के प्रिमिटिव इंस्टिंक्टों में से एक इंस्टिंक्ट है। जब हम इंसान बोलना भी नहीं जानते थे, यानी भाषा का आविष्कार भी नहीं हुआ था, तब भी हम इंसान अपने आप को एक्सप्रेस करने के लिए चित्रों का प्रयोग करते थे, जिसका उदाहरण रॉक पेंटिंग पूरे दुनिया में मिलता है। हमारे देश में ये रॉक आर्ट मुख्यतः साउथ इंडिया, मध्य प्रदेश और उत्तर प्रदेश में पाया जाता है, लेकिन हाल ही में कुछ दिन पहले दिल्ली के बिल्कुल नजदीक अरावली की पर्वतों में ये पाया गया। ये रॉक आर्ट जब हम इंसान गुफाओं में जंगलों में रहते थे, यानी हम इंसान आदि मानव हुआ करते थे, तो वे बड़े बड़े पत्थरों पर और जिन गुफाओं को वो अपना घर बना के रहते थे उनकी दीवारों पर और छतों पे पाई गई है। इन रॉक आर्ट में मुख्यतः देखने को मिलता है उनके दिनचर्या का कार्यक्रम, और देखा गया है जानवरों की आकृति जिसमें मुख्यतः घोड़े, हाथी, शेर और जंगली सुअर है, और कहीं कोई देखा गया है कि जैसे वे जो कबीले होते थे उन दोनों में जैसे कबीलों के बीच में युद्ध हो गया है, तो उसका चित्र और मिला है जैसे कि वो साथ में एक साथ नृत्य कर रहे हैं, या शिकार में गए हैं किसी जानवर का, या कोई जानवर उनको आक्रमण किया है, तो ज्यादातर चित्र इस तरह की मिली है। और आखिरी दिनों में इनमें मिला है परिवार के चित्र, शायद परिवार का संगठन होने लग गया था। देखा गया है कि जो महिलाएं हैं उसमें वे खाना बना रही है, और जो पुरुष हैं वो पालतू जानवरों के साथ कुछ कर रहे हैं। इन चित्रों को बनाने में वे इस्तेमाल करते थे ज़्यादातर लाल रंग का, काले रंग का और सफ़ेद रंग का, और ये रंग वे अपने गुफाओं के आसपास में उगने वाले पेड़ के खाल और पत्तियों से बनाया करते थे।
Now let's travel from the Stone Age to thousands of years later to the Bronze Age. Can you guess where we have reached? That's right. One of the earliest civilizations of the world. The Indus Valley Civilization, also called Sindhu Ghati ki Sabhyata in Hindi. Bronze sculptures, terracotta, and sandstone usage. A phrase comes to mind: to create order in chaos is art. We see realistic depiction of art in this period. Let's take a look at this major sculpture from that period called Bearded Man or Priest Man, made of steatite. The shawl is decorated with a trefoil pattern. The eyes are elongated and half closed, as in a meditative concentration. This next image is of a seal. Thousands of seals were discovered from the site, and their use was mainly commercial. Every seal is engraved in a pictographic script, which is yet to be deciphered.
अब आगे बढ़ते हैं मौर्य काल की ओर. सिंधु घाटी के सभ्यता के समाप्त होने के बहुत बड़े अंतराल के बाद आया मौर्यकालीन युग, और ये काल पिछले कालों से बहुत ज़्यादा डेवलप्ड और कलात्मक था, विशेषकर अशोका के काल में. अब आपको दिखाते हैं अशोका स्तंभ. ये स्तंभ मौर्यन राजा अशोका ने बनवाया था. पूरे उपमहाद्वीप में जगह जगह पर ये स्तंभ पाए गए हैं. इन स्तंभों को धम्मा थम्मा यानी के धर्म का स्तंभ भी बोला जाता है. आज की तारीख में ये स्तंभ 12 के लगभग ठीक ठाक हालत में है. इन स्तंभों के शिखर पर होते थे शेर की आकृति. बाद में दो स्तंभों को बादशाह तुगलक ने दिल्ली में पुनर्स्थापित किया था, और मुगलों ने जानवरों की आकृति को हटा के स्तंभों को जगह जगह में स्थापित की. और ये है मौर्य काल का एक बेहतरीन स्टोन स्कल्पचर, जिसे हम यक्षी या यक्षिणी कहते हैं. 3rd century BC में बना ये सुंदर स्कल्पचर अपनी सुंदरता के अलावा अपनी पॉलिशिंग के लिए भी जाना जाता है. अगली इमेज है स्तूपा सांची की. ये स्तूपा बुद्धिस्ट धर्म को मानने वाले लोगों के लिए एक महत्वपूर्ण जगह है. ये सांची के स्तूपा भोपाल से लगभग 46 किलोमीटर दूरी पे बना हुआ है. इस स्तूपा को अशोका की पत्नी देवी ने अपने देखरेख में बनवाया था. अब आपका ध्यान मैं एक महत्वपूर्ण तस्वीर की ओर खींचना चाहता हूं. ये है लायन कैपिटल. इसे अशोका स्तंभ के ऊपर रखा जाता है, जिसमें बना हुआ है 4 एशियन लायन, और जिसके नीचे बनी है आकृति हाथी, घोड़ा और बैल की, और बीच बीच में बने हैं चक्र, और इन चक्रों में बना है 24 लकीरें. 1950 में इसे हमने अपना देश का एम्बलम की तरह से भी चुना, और ये है 1947 में आजाद होने के बाद देश का पहला स्टैम्प, जिसके अंदर भी ये लायन कैपिटल देखा जा सकता है। चलिए अब चलते हैं भारत के मंदिरों के आर्ट और आर्किटेक्चरी की ओर। इन मंदिरों की जो कलाकृतियां हैं, भारत के कला इतिहास को वो गर्वित करते हैं। भारत के किसी भी दिशा में चले जाएं, आपको वहां प्राचीन मंदिर मिल ही जाएंगे। सबसे पहले जिक्र आता है महाबलीपुरम, साउथ में जो टेंपल है उसका। 8वीं शताब्दी में ये एक शोर टेंपल है। इसे शोर टेंपल इसलिए कहा जाता है क्योंकि ये समुद्र के किनारे बसा हुआ है। 8वीं शताब्दी में बंगाल की खाड़ियों में ये मंदिरों का समूह देखने को बनता है। पल्लव राजाओं में नरसिम्हम देव ने अपने कार्यकाल में ये मंदिरें बनवाई। इनमें दो मंदिर सबसे ज्यादा महत्वपूर्ण है, एक जो भगवान शिव को समर्पित है और दूसरा जो भगवान विष्णु को। नॉर्थ के मंदिर से ये मंदिर थोड़ा भिन्न है। नॉर्थ में जैसे शिखर का चलन है, और ये जो मंदिर है ये पिरामिडियल स्ट्रक्चर को टेप्स में रख के बनाया गया है। 2500 साल पुराना बसा मदुराई शहर में मीनाक्षी अम्मा टेंपल, जिसे मीनाक्षी टेंपल के नाम से दुनिया जानती है, ये दक्षिण का सबसे बड़ा ग्रुप ऑफ टेंपल्स है। ये टेंपल 1100 शताब्दी में पांड्या राजाओं ने अपने कार्यकाल में बनवाया। इसमें मुख्यतर जो टेंपल है वो है मीनाक्षी यानी पार्वती, सुंदरेश्वर यानी के भगवान शिव का ये मुख्य रूप से मंदिर है। 1400 शताब्दी में मदुराई शहर का नष्ट होने के कारण से ये मंदिर काफी वक्त तक बंद रहा। बाद के राजाओं ने इसे दीवारों से फोर्टिफाई कर दिया था, पर बाद में अंग्रेज सरकार ने इन दीवारों को तोड़ डाला। अब चलते हैं पूरब की ओर। उड़ीसा में बसा समुन्दर किनारे एक और शोर टेंपल, जिसका नाम है कोणार्क। 1300 शताब्दी में नरसिम्हम देव राजा ने इसका निर्माण किया था। ये मुख्यतर सूर्य देवता को समर्पित मंदिर है, जिसके अंदर सूर्य देवता का रथ देखने लायक है। इसमें रथ पे जो है देखने को मिलता है एरोटिक स्कल्पचर, एरोटिक आर्ट, जो बहुत ही सुंदर है। ये एरोटिक आर्ट मंदिरों के दीवारों में भी देखने को मिलता है। ये पूरे दुनिया में बहुत मशहूर है। इस आर्ट को कलिंग आर्ट भी कहा जाता है। ये एरोटिक स्कल्पचर का स्किल देखने योग्य है। ये मंदिरों का समूह जो है आज की तारीख में विध्वंस अवस्था में है, जिसका कि भारत सरकार का आर्कियोलॉजिकल डिपार्टमेंट रेस्टोरेशन कर रही है। ये मंदिर विध्वंस कैसे हुआ कहना कुछ मुश्किल है। कुछ कहते हैं कि मुसलमान राजाओं ने, बादशाहों ने इनको तोड़ा। और कुछ का कहना है, लोग इस कला को अश्लील समझकर इनको तोड़ने की कोशिश करी।
Now, let's talk about Khajuraho, known for its erotic art outside the temple. It has several thousands of sculptures. The vast majority of arts depicts various aspects of everyday life, mythical stories, as well as symbolic displays of various secular, spiritual values important to the Hindu tradition. Until the 12th century, Khajuraho was known to have 85 temples. However, in the 13th century, when central India was seized by the Delhi Sultanate, most temples were either destroyed or eroded with time due to neglect. Now, unfortunately, only 22 temples are still surviving. Now let's travel from the south to the east to the city of 20 terracotta temples of Bishnupur, Bengal. The walls depict scenes from the Mahabharata and the Ramayana. These temples, built by the Mala rulers, have certainly stood the test of time.
महाराष्ट्र के औरंगाबाद में है अजंता की गुफाएं। ये मंदिरों का एक समूह है जो कि स्ट्रक्चर मंदिरों से काफी अलग है। इनको जो है फर्स्ट सेंचुरी बीसी के आसपास गुफाओं के अंदर और बड़े बड़े पत्थरों को काट के बनवाया गया था। यहाँ करीब 29 गुफाएं हैं जिसके अंदर अनगिनत म्यूरल्स और स्कल्पचर मिलते हैं जो कि उस समय के बुद्धिस्ट जो मॉन्क्स होते थे वो अपने साधना और पूजा अर्चना के लिए इस्तेमाल करते थे। इनमें जो म्यूरल्स है उसमें ज्यादातर म्यूरल बुद्धा के पिछले जन्म और पुनर्जन्म के घटनाओं पे आधारित है। इन म्यूरलों में से एक म्यूरल जिसमें बोधिसत्व पदमपना में भगवान बुद्ध को एक नीले रंग के कमल हाथ में थामे देखा जा सकता है जो कि बहुत ही सुंदर है।
लोकेटेड इन औरंगाबाद डिस्ट्रिक्ट ऑफ महाराष्ट्र, एलोरा केव्स विच हैव बीन क्लासिफाइड एज द यूनेस्को वर्ल्ड हेरिटेज इन 1983 इज वन ऑफ द वर्ल्ड्स लार्जेस्ट रॉक कट हिंदू टेम्पल केव्स। It is not often one comes across a seamless amalgamation of different arts, where painting, sculpture, and architecture fuse into a united whole. In the Ellora caves, it is as if the artisans had mastered this technique. Without one realizing where one ends and the other begins. Let's talk about the Chola dynasty next. Situated in southern India, it is one of the longest ruling dynasty in the world's history. They continued the tradition of temple building just as the Pallavas, and contributed significantly to the Dravidian temple design. Their lasting legacy consisted of the artistic temple sculptures and Chola bronzes of Hindu deities such as Meenakshi temple and Madurai bronze sculpture. Let's move on to Indo-Islamic architecture and art. Since the Islamic religion forbids anthropomorphic sculpture or painting, the art on the surface of one of the seven wonders of the world, the Taj Mahal, consists mainly of abstract art in the form of abstract forms and curvilinear vegetative motifs. This can be said about all of Indo-Islamic art. Some might even have inscriptions from the Quran. For example, the Qutub Minar, a 73 meter high victory tower in Delhi, made mainly of red sandstone. To give you a brief background of Indo-Islamic architecture, it can be divided into five parts. First, the Arab presence in Sindh. Second, the Delhi Sultanate. Third, pre-Mughal regional architecture. Fourth, Mughal architecture. And lastly, fifth, post-Mughal Islamic architecture.
अब बात करते हैं भारत के मिनिएचर आर्ट की। ये मिनिएचर आर्ट 7th सेंचुरी में पाया गया, सबसे पहले बंगाल के पाला डायनेस्टी के समय में। इन मिनिएचरों में पाया गया ताड़ के पत्तों में बनी बुद्धिस्ट मैनुस्क्रिप्ट्स और बुद्धिस्ट इमेजेस। बाद में 16 और 17 शताब्दी में इनको प्रोत्साहन मिला राजस्थान के राजाओं के दरबार में। उस समय तब के कलाकार इनको पारंपरिक तरीके से उन दरबारों में बनाया करते थे। इनमें वे मुख्यतर रामायण, महाभारत, राधा कृष्ण और सुंदर लैंडस्केप बनाते थे। राजस्थान के राजाओं के दरबार के अलावा इन्हें प्रोत्साहन मिला मुगल दरबार में। मिनिएचर्स के अंदर भारतीय परंपरा के अलावा दिखने लगी पर्शियन मिनिएचर्स का इफेक्ट और चाइनीज कला का इफेक्ट। इन मुगल मिनिएचरों के सब्जेक्ट ज्यादातर सेकुलर होते थे। इनमें सुंदर लैंडस्केप के अलावा पाया गया है बादशाह और उनके बेगमों की पोर्ट्रेट्स।
पहाड़ी पेंटिंग डन मोस्टली इन मिनिएचर फॉर्म्स ओरिजिनेटिंग फ्रॉम हिमालयन हिल किंगडम्स ऑफ नॉर्थ इंडिया। पहाड़ी पेंटिंग ग्रू आउट ऑफ द मुगल पेंटिंग, दो दिस वॉज पेट्रनाइज्ड मोस्टली बाय द राजपूत किंग्स हु रूल्ड मेनी पार्ट्स ऑफ द रीजन एंड गेव बर्थ टू अ न्यू इडियम इन इंडियन पेंटिंग। बंगाल स्कूल was an art movement that originated in Shantiniketan and flourished throughout the Indian subcontinent. During the British Raj in the early 20th century, it was led by Abindranath Tagore. It arose as an avant-garde and nationalist movement reacting against the academic art styles previously promoted in India by artists such as Raja Ravi Verma. Some of the famous pupils of Abhindranath Tagore were Nandalal Bose, who was one of the pioneers of modern Indian art and a key figure of contextual modernism. Another pupil, Jamini Roy, was honored with the State Award of Padma Bhushan in the year 1954. His artistic originality and contribution to the emergence of art in India remains unquestionable. Born in Hungary to a Sikh father and a Hungarian Jewish mother, Amrita Shergill was an anomaly when she returned to India and pursued her passion for painting. Shergill's free-flowing style and liberal nature was not appreciated in her work during her lifetime. Shergill's art was recognized only after her death in 1941. She died early at a young age of 28, but she paved the way of expressing contemporary reality through modern art. Let's look at one of Shergill's paintings titled Three Women. It shows a somber and melancholy mood. It speaks to the heart of every woman in the unspoken foreshadowing of uncertainty facing them as they embark into adulthood and marriage. This is highlighted by the use of a minimalistic background, shifting focus on the women. The three different colors of attire and the detailing of selective shading of the figure and the face add the drama of the composition. Shergill moves away from realism learned in Paris to a more modernist style where line and color are selectively used. It is believed she was influenced by French painter Paul Gauguin. So much has been written about M.F. Hussain, India's Picasso. Though horses were what bulls were to Picasso, sometimes somber, at times quirky, he was never dull or without purpose. His career spanned 80 decades, started with painting Bollywood billboards. Themes extended from the Battle of Karbala, Mother Teresa, the Mahabharata, and Mohandas Gandhi. This untitled painting from the Mother Teresa series is a testament to the impact the saint had on M.F. Hussain. Many Hussain enthusiasts believe this series represents the deep love Hussain had for his mother, who he lost as a baby, and the effect of the ethical practices on people, such as being pious, selfless, and kind. Hussain said he was inspired by Mother Teresa's life because he saw her as a divine saint. Like the Virgin Mary, who for people of Christian faith symbolizes selflessness and universal love. Maqbool Fida Hussain was deeply moved by meeting Mother Teresa during his lifetime. In this painting, he references Michelangelo's Pietà as Mother Teresa is holding the dying man on her lap. Light and hope are referenced in use of bright colors of red and yellow in contrast to faceless Mother Teresa in stark white and blue. One can see influences of Renaissance art in theme of motherhood and sacrifice. This famous painting by Hossein shows a rainbow spectrum of five horses jumping across the canvas against the backdrop of splashes of brilliant reds, giving polarity to the deep blue sun. In Indian mythology, the horse is revered as a symbol of the sun, of power, knowledge, and fertility. Now I would like to shift your focus to an important era in the development of modernism in the contemporary art scene, known as the avant-garde progressive art movement. It was started by F.M. Sousa. Though founded by Sousa, the progressives never exhibited together as a group. Their affinity for experimentation has made the individuals in the group giants of the 20th century Indian art. Many left India in the 1950s and 60s, including Sousa, who moved to New York and lived there until returning to India shortly before his death. Painted in 1964, the Goan landscape is a perfect example of Sousa's abstract and eclectic style. Here, the houses are intentionally not symmetrical, the lines heavy and convoluted. The structures are cheerful and rosy in Sousa's world and often appear scrambled and mixed up. The rebel Sousa, seeing the world as a random delight. Painted in 1990 and inspired by Leonardo da Vinci's iconic painting, one of the most recognizable images in Western civilization, Sousa painted his own version, in which he has defined an equally riveting and recognizable style. Painted in oil on canvas, it's an eclectic adaptation of Christ's Last Supper, with Christ standing in the center in front of a long table, surrounded by his disciples. Raza is one of India's most important and decorated 20th century painter. Early career revolved around impressionist, abstract landscapes. Later in his career, he focused on the circle or bindu. He conceived the bindu to be the center of creation, like a seed or a beach, an existence. He made it a holistic space in sacred harmony with the universe. The circle of mandala is used by the Jains, Hindus, Buddhists, and Tibetans in their ritual imaging of the sacred. In using the circle as an indispensable motif in his paintings, Raza created a galaxy within the essence of the deep core of the human soul. Raza returned to India in 1970 and concentrated on Indian culture. This painting was made on his trip to Rajasthan. He found Rajasthan like a festival of colors. Under the radiant sun, it glowed hues of deep reds and yellows. Krishan Khanna is one of the most respected and senior artists in India today. Hailing from Lailapur, in pre-partition India, the narratives of his paintings are a chronology of his interests and life experiences. Khanna veered away from abstractionism and concentrated on figures and form. theatrical representation of bourgeoisie India, where even middle-class marriages are festooned with the regalia of colorfully dressed band members of a marching band. Abstract, figurative style, splashes of color of bright red, yellow, contrasting with blue and white. Abstract figures of two classical musicians seated can be seen in this next painting of Khanna, a tabla player and a sitarist. Vasudev Gaitonde, considered one of the greatest painters of the 20th century. Gaitonde was deeply moved by the entire influences of Western artists of his time. He, however, was able to assimilate Western technique from Cubism to collate and metabolize Western thought processes and make them his own, thus luminously creating a distinguishable yet delicate, stylized, abstract canvas. This untitled, green-hued work of art illuminated Gaitonde's aura using a delicate patterning, tone-on-tone motif stretching across the canvas. This abstract landscape epitomizes the artist's brilliant brushwork and layered coloring to achieve the effect of light through the olive colors to obtain a delicate contrast. As one of India's leading artists, Tayab Mehta struggled most of his life, though he came out on top of his field. Today, his paintings fetch colossal prices and are sought after. The painting, Virtuoso's minimalistic themes and composition, coupled with vibrant chunks of color, command the accolades and attention of critics and art connoisseurs alike. Kali represents Tayab Mehta in all his glory. It has all the forces of creation, destruction, and nurturing. Known as the father of modern printmaking in India, Somnath Hoare is credited with experimenting with intaglios, aquatints in the 1960s. Creating pulp, print techniques, and most importantly, bringing professional printmaking to India. Hoare is remembered as an artist for the poor, the weak, and the impoverished, who gave images and representation to their lives. Depicting events in history as a human drama, throughout his life, from the Bengal famine of 1943 to Nagasaki, and effects of nuclear power on the world to modern day worker, themes of inequality and suffering were depicted throughout his career.
Well, it is very difficult to share the process of the painting. It comes and it goes, and how it comes I can't tell you, but first it comes in the memory, and I think about it, and while painting it actually becomes a different thing altogether, which cannot be explained beforehand. It goes on gradually. Well, this is the thing. That process cannot be explained.
From the first footprint or the prints of the hands on walls, the journey of the Indian print art has created a global platform and impact.
one of India's most reticent and quirky artists, Ganesh Pine, never held an exhibition, but preferred to privately exhibit his paintings, three at a time. Nevertheless, his artworks fetched fabulous amounts in both India and through international auctions like Sotheby's. A wonderful example of Pine's technique, the lamp and effigy, demonstrates Pine's use of multiple layering of translucent paint. He is known to burnish the paint after to give the effect of light and space and highlight the contrast in shadow and light on the canvas. Inspired by the mix of the Bengal School of Art and Pine's own poetic, surrealism, black imagery and fantasy, The Mass is an important work by the artist. The modern imagery is presented with traditional dull colors, highlighted by detail in the figures and individual forms, giving an unsettling volatility to the canvas. Jogin Chaudhary brought a bit of Paris home with him when he returned to India in 1968.
Yogendra, could you share the process of your painting?
Thank you, Sanjay, for your question. Yes, my major works of art are done in pen and ink and mixed media on paper. Of course, I do work in other mediums too.
Do you visualize your painting beforehand?
Yes, I continue to think and visualize my works all the time. But when I actually sit to work, it gradually takes new shapes, which are charged with my aesthetic emotion and instant ideas.
Chaudhary is famous for his luxurious watercolors and pastel paintings. Creating his own style, he takes tradition from the Bengal school and meshes it with crosshatch fine lines, covering the canvas, which are filled in with a dash of flesh tones to give texture to his work. Let's talk about this painting of Chaudhary at the Glenbara Museum of Art called The Three Women. Part of the Japanese art collector Masanari Fukuoka's 400 pieces of art were completed by Chaudhary between 1995 and 2005. Famous for her diaries, which refer to Kazimir Malevich and Vasily Kandinsky, Nasreen Mohammadi was a maverick in the employment of constructivism and suprematism. Her work, primarily linear drawings and geometric in form, though her career was non-linear during her lifetime, with her achieving fame primarily in India. Following her death in 1990, her work has revitalized and the momentum has catapulted her to international acclaim, especially in the last two decades. Mohammadi is compared to the iconic American painter Agnes Martin and is considered to be one of the most important artists of the 20th century due to the nature of her art.
Sir, you were a student of Ramkinkar Bai. Can you share some interesting moment or some incident with him?
Ramkinkar is a true product of Shantiniketan, especially of Nandala. One of the incidents is that when I was doing a terracotta image around 2 or 3 feet height of a mother and child, I almost built up, because it's a coil process, so you have to build up little by little and wait for a few days to dry and then again build it up. So it's a little laborious process and you need a lot of patience. So almost a month or 1.5 months I worked and brought it up to around 3.5-4 feet height. So Kingartha just entered the class and looked at my sculpture, and he walked up to me and he said, "A key korchu? What are you doing?" So I said, "A key." What's your mother and said, "Structure kodhai?" Where is the structure? So I didn't know what structure he is talking about. So he lifted a wooden log which was lying, and he gave a huge blow on my sculpture.
He was actually trying to
shape the sculpture, but because it was coil process, the whole thing collapsed.
And
spread all the studio. He said, "Pick it up, prepare the clay and start again." So without saying anything, I just picked up the clay and started working again.
Arpita Singh's art is a form of abstract expression where figure, narrative, and characterization are central in theme and composition. She paints people from events, her community, family, and friends, depicting tension and relationships, emblematic of larger societal and political issues, and weaves emotions of happiness with gloom and sadness. Set in tones of cool lilac and blue, this painting, titled Bhishma, is a symphony of battle and unresolved violence, but constructed with Singh's delicate brushwork. This gives the painting a sense of weightlessness, even in the warring figures. Based on the battle of Bhishma, Singh depicts the Pandavas as warring men in a scene which comes before the triumph of good over evil. British sculptor of Indian diaspora, Anish Kapoor, is an internationally acclaimed member of a generation of new British sculptors. He is famous for his extraordinary Pièce de Résistance, for their modern, minimalistic structures, yet extensive scale. Let's talk about one of his earlier works. The vivid colors of red, yellow, and black dominate this sculpture. The delicate edges of the shapes contrast against the colors. Kapoor's use of color has an immediate effect on our experience of seeing the sculpture, transforming the object into a sculptural image. Kapoor's use of color has a universal, historical, and cultural significance. Let's talk about this very famous sculpture of the artist. Inspired by liquid mercury, the sculpture's surface reflects and distorts the city's skyline. On the underside is the omphalos, which is Greek for navel, which is a concave chamber that wraps and multiplies reflections.
Shri Rameshwar Bhutta, जो भारत के साथ साथ पूरे एशिया महाद्वीप में सबसे सक्सेसफुल आर्टिस्ट के नाम से जाने जाते हैं, और मेरा तो ये कहना है, अगर आज के समय में इंटरनेशनल लेवल पे कोई यहाँ से काम कर रहे हैं तो वो है श्री रामेश्वर ब्रूटा। एक इंटरनेशनल सर्वे एजेंसी के हिसाब से उनका नाम दुनिया के टॉप 100 आर्टिस्टों में से आता है, जिनमें वैन गॉग और पिकासो आते हैं। शुरुआत के दिनों में उनके काम में देखा जाता था आसपास के गरीब कामगार। बाद में इन कामगारों में से निकला उनका गोरिल्ला सीरीज या एप सीरीज। इन कामों में देखने को मिलता था काफी सटायर और देखने को मिलता था हमारे इंसानों के अंदर जो अब भी है प्रिमिटिव एनिमल इंस्टिंक्ट। धीरे धीरे ये गोरिल्ला मैन में परिवर्तित होने लगा।
लेट्स टॉक अबाउट वन ऑफ ब्रूटा'स वर्क्स, ट्रेसेस ऑफ मैन, क्रिएटेड बाय द आर्टिस्ट इन द ईयर 1999. एग्जिस्टेंशियल डिपिक्शन ऑफ मैन इन स्पेस, अनोनिमस एंड एफेमरल. ब्रूटा एक्सप्लोर्स हाफ इमेजेस, द शैडोई अनोनिमिटी दैट सोसाइटी इम्पोजेस ऑन द कंटेम्प्रेरी इंडिविजुअल. लेट्स टॉक अबाउट ब्रूटाज मैन सीरीज. दिस पेंटिंग टाइटल्ड मैन वन वॉज पेंटेड by the artist in 1980. Bruta shifts his focus from outward concerns to looking inwards. The result is a monochromatic palette. The viewer focuses on the external beauty of the physique but also looks to inner conflict. As Bruta paints without details, leaving the imagination to ponder the essence of humanity, spirit, fragility, death, and resilience, age, disintegration, to highlight in this series male vulnerability. In this next painting by the artist, untitled, painted in 2014, his latest works depicts men wearing different clothes, as if stating man has three avatars, mind, heart, and soul, but is united that each individual seeks his own destiny. One of 20th century India's most successful surrealist painters, Bikash Bhattacharya's paintings evoke a detailed record of the life of people of Kolkata, their religion, dreams, travesty, and violence since colonial rule and its aftermath. Bhattacharya is credited with revolting with his contemporaries and for bringing realism to 20th century contemporary art in India. He sought to avoid abstraction and the distortion of figures. In this work of 1981, a bride sits alone in a dark interior. The dark colors of browns, sienna, umber, blacks, grays, and blues give a sense of foreboding and her future married life. Despite the heavy influences of the Pahari tradition and Rajasthani miniature art, Indian painter Alpana Kaur has a highly individual sensibility and symbolism. In the artist's words, scissors stand for time, knives and weapons for threats and danger, matkas or mud pots for the mortal body, and a fallen leaf for nature. Feet transcend time, epitomizing our twin desires to be both rooted and to fly. Her art speaks directly to the viewer, reminding us of our mortality, our socio-economic inequality, and our growing distance from nature.
The process that I have in my creativity has been changing over the years. But what I really enjoy is making lots of sketches. So it starts on paper with a rough sketch, and then I keep refining it. I do several small drawings, and then ultimately from that whatever inspires me most, I work on that on the larger surface. So it's a slow process, but I enjoy every step of it. And there are several small works that are complete works before the large one is done, and the large one is always different also because it's innovated as it goes along. But I need that clarity. So for that clarity, I have a lot of work that I put in. That's my process.
The expression on the face, you read with the body language. The same expression of a smiling face, it really changes its color. It has become Ramakrishna with the kind of posture, and that smile was so divine, so serene. But when it became Semaiya, when she was playing violin, it was very different.
People wonder what makes Indian art different from the rest of the world. Immediately after the partition, when India gained independence in 1947, the generation of artists emerging at the time blatantly wanted to defy the Western Boksa and the tradition rooted in academia, even though most of these artists had been educated through this traditional Western system. Thanks to the progressives and other art groups that emerged and revolted in the 1950s and 60s, India has shaped its own niche, and the gap between our contemporary modern artists and the rest of the world has narrowed immensely. Today's Indian artist is recognized throughout the world, stretching from the Far East in China to America. Indian artists have come far, utilizing abstraction in a contemplative and meditative cadence. They are playing a pivotal role in the present exploration and pushing the future pursuit of untraveled terrain with boldness. Here are some of India's contemporary modern artists that we are going to discuss today. So let's get started.
Mumbai-based contemporary painter Atul Dodia, वो अपने कैनवस के अलावा अपने असेंबलेज, इंस्टॉलेशन और वीडियो आर्ट के लिए भी जाने जाते हैं। उनके काम में देखने को मिलता है काफी सटायर।
लेट्स टॉक अबाउट वन ऑफ डोडियाज अनटाइटल्ड वर्क, महालक्ष्मी। डोडिया यूजेस महालक्ष्मी एज अ काउंटर पॉइंट टू द केओस इन मॉडर्न इंडिया। इन द सेकेंड इमेज विच अपीयर्स आफ्टर द फर्स्ट लेयर इज लिफ्टेड, he produces a photograph which appeared in the newspaper of a group suicide by hanging, resorted to by young women whose families had been unable to pay dowry. The newspaper cutting changes the theme from religion to tragedy. Let's talk about another work of the artist called Karuna, which is enamel paint, synthetic varnish and an acrylic epoxy on laminate. In this work, Dodia takes iconic images from Indian cinema, signposting stalwarts of India's Bollywood industry in a medley of images.
बैजू प्रधान, उनके काम में क्रिएटिविटी के साथ साथ देखने को मिलता है डिजिटल क्यूरोसिटी और प्रोग्रामिंग।
बुद्धा इज डिपिक्टेड वाइकेरियसली मेडिटेटिंग इन अ वर्चुअल स्पेस फिल्ड विद मोटिव्स of chakras, birds and lines in this work of Parthan. Osmograph, literally a graphic record of osmotic force, which by definition is extension of the natural law that all matter will become randomly distributed over time. An alumnus of the JJ School of Art in Mumbai, Sudarshan Shetty has worked in a variety of mediums, including painting, sculpture, and installations. His affinity with working in different materials, such as metal, ceramic, terracotta, in addition to traditional paint, has led to the development of many projects. Let's talk about one of Shetty's sculptures, his metal Taj Mahal, which is on top of four phalluses. It was exhibited at a prestigious gallery in Bangalore. Let's talk about another work of this artist. It's an installation called Path to Water. In this work, Shetty explores the notion of recapitulation of open meanings. Five hand-carved wood represent the Indian landscape, rendered as a hybrid image on one face. Alongside the reliefs are terracotta objects placed on a long, low plinth in a haphazard manner. The objects, culled from street vendors, resembles discarded items of an archaeological excavation.
Art from my childhood, you know, I've been creating my own toys, my own way to play myself, you know, which I think I'm completely meant for the as an artist, you know. So I always take inspiration from the surrounding you, my childhood experience and my personal experience. There is a lot of the experience which is, you can see, you know, which is comes out always, you know. So, for example, something which is, you know, I have been working with the familiar with an ash in Vibhuti. So, the Vibhuti have is, it has an, significant, you know, it has its own stories, you know, it has its own values, you know, spiritual values, and the life and death, you know, there is a lot of mythology involved, you know, even significant values it has, you know. So, having medium as a ash, you know, which is in my work, you know. So something like that, you know, I always been getting inspiration, and the material is very important for me. The object is very important for me. Subject matter is very important for me. So I get most of the time from my observation, you know.
Art historian or artist Anita Dubey, जो कि पहले वुमन आर्ट क्यूरेटर थे कोच्चि बिनाले के, जिनका काम हम लोगों ने देखा दिल्ली के किरण नाडर म्यूजियम में, खोज इंटरनेशनल में और नेचर मोट में। इसके अलावा मुंबई में भाऊदाजी म्यूजियम में और लकीरे गैलरी में।
इन इंडिया who is famous for pushing boundaries in experimentation with materiality. Let's talk about one of Dubey's works called The Silence, Blood Wedding, which was made in 1997 and is at the Kiran Nadar Museum in New Delhi. The Blood Wedding is described by Dubey as a rejection of death. The artist covered real human bones in a skin of red velvet embellished with beads and lace. Displayed in 13 vitrines, these objects signify a difficult time in her personal life, when her father was diagnosed with a fatal illness and she was dealing with a broken relationship.
We are living in a time where we are surrounded by many kind of informations. Art to me is something which gives me an opportunity to understand the importance of formation.
Our next artist is our own friendly host for this program today. Sanjay Roy is a Delhi-based artist who paints surreal, abstract figures and landscapes. He is a senior mentor at the acclaimed Triveni Kala Sangam. His paintings can be viewed countless times with a fresh, contemplative and meditative perspective, giving powerful introspection to the role of creative invention in allowing us deeper insights about society and ourselves. In this work of Roy, he creates a background of muted yellow hues. Roy delves into a philosophical and existential universe. Based on his personal experiences with spirituality, probing accepted truths, he transports us into his perspective of virtual reality. In this painting, a pictorial image of man conquering the rigors of an anvil is depicted. The figure is incidental, while the anvil at the center is set against an abstract landscape, and in the composition rises like a sculpture from the busy space. A study on random form and irregular shapes within a realistic urban setting, Roy's canvas is brimming with a motley array of colors and highlighting the effect of space and light within a complex, chaotic, abstract landscape. The canvas bustles with buildings and patterns using multiple layers of paint in deep red, orange, grey, and green. Roy engages the viewer to absorb the different planes of light and shape amongst the activity in muted rumination. And apart from his canvas, he is also known for his video art and short films. One of his short film won Best Film of the Year award in 2019, which has also been screened in many important festivals. This year, at an important art festival in California, USA, one of his video arts was included from India. With this, we conclude our little journey for today. I hope you enjoyed learning about Indian art, the beautiful and significant history of our country. Thank you for your attention. I would also like to thank the Ministry of Culture for putting this program together. And my humble apologies that everything had to be covered in such a short time. Indian art and architecture is rooted in our history, culture, and religion. With such vast topics to cover, this certainly doesn't do justice to our ever-growing heritage. Thank you. Namaste and Jai Hind.